rural economy encompasses people in a rural area who engage in agriculture and who engage other things apart from agriculture. So the rural economy is based on agriculture, is a farm, non-farm economy. Today, when we are talking about rural people, we keep on talking about food security. And that itself is part of the problem. It's a narrowing of the opportunities that the rural sector provided a long time ago into a modern thing in which, having failed the challenges of transforming the rural economy, the vibrant part of the modern economy, we are then just throwing them socks and say, food security, targeted cash transfers, this and that, which is our president. The question I'm going to ask is, what is happening in the rural economy? How is it constructed and shaped by the failures and stagnation of the overall economy that we have? What are some of the ways that this can be addressed through a mutually reinforcing link between lifting the constraints in the modern industrial sector, in the service sector, and the rural sector? Without addressing the problems of the rural economy, the rest of the economy cannot move. Okay. 75% or so of the economically active population in Tanzania is involved in agriculture. And yet, agriculture only contributes 24.1% of the GDP. Think about it. 24.1% of the GDP divided by 75% of the economically active population. 75% of the people in the Tanzanian economy are living in a way that are going to release their full potential of labor to earn income, to do the things that they have to do, and go about their life in a way that lifts everybody up. It also means that all the wealth in quotes that is contained in rural labor is not being realized. So it's 75% of the people who are exercising their labor minimally the rest of the economy. It means that the economy is not about to expand. Now put this in the context that 562 million people are involved in small farming activities. This is a huge population, and if you take the Tanzanian example, who are 75% their labor on that. If you take the typical unit or enterprise that produces for domestic consumption, it's likely to be somebody, maybe a woman, somebody farming something less than 1 acre. 1 acre of plot size. And a woman is there with 7 children. At the end of the year, they harvest 10 baskets of tomatoes. Right? The 10 baskets of tomatoes now have to leave the rural area and come to the market in Accra, where it competes with subsidized Italian tomato paste. In fact, in Ghana now, Italian tomato is not brought as tomatoes. It is brought in paste forms and canned in Ghana. Right? So the competition is fierce. Okay? But that woman enjoys nothing like irrigation services. In fact, only 1% of all farms, food farms in Africa, are irrigated. 1%. Think about it. There was a time when if you're farming in that place, you can have access to rural banking, most of the city's bank, and therefore can concessionary money. Today is an abolished from that. Education has been privatized, health has been privatized, everything has been privatized. Everything that the post-colonial government tried to provide the rural economy has been taken away. In a post-colonial setting, our government provides clinics, provide this. I come from a rural area, but I enjoy free scholarship to go all the way to university on the Cocoa Marketing Board scholarship. I was not from Cocoa Marketing Board. When that thing was destroyed and undermined, my poorer sisters who came after me just fell off the education route because my father and mother were too poor to take on the debt of education. So rural credit has been replaced by the usurious money lender who is now pairing with macro credit. The problem also has a particular different problem because we're talking about that woman with a 1 acre farm. Now the nature of the economic relationship in that farm itself is worth investigating. This is where my family's colleagues can help us. Because it's not simply about whether or not you're a farmer who have resources and access to resources. But the relations of property and power means that the majority of the people there who are on that family farm, who are women, have the most tenuous and precarious access to the resources that they need. Land, credit, technology, everything. And because because they have so tenuous an access to land, credit, technology, even their own production is undermined by their past. All of them, all are the olden days where they meet their basic consumption needs from their farms, now they meet it from the market. So their health, their kerosene, their fuel, their tomato, their thing that they consume, they buy it from the capitalist market. And that is not under their control. So you have a situation where the people's consumption needs is procured from the market where the prices are set outside their control, and their productive needs, their income needs, is generated from within the farming system, which is whose level of labor is low. So you have a classic case of an import exchange. There's nothing like infrastructure, there's nothing like insurance, and the reason why, therefore, seven children have to farm on the less than 1 acre farm and produce 10 baskets of tomato. Is that why we have 75% of the people working at budget only producing 20%? So, how can you address this kind of situation? My argument is that you cannot address it simply by saying, let's focus on food producers. That's part of CADEP. CADEP says African government can invest 10% of their budget in rural agriculture. What they forgot to say, but in what kind of agriculture and why? First of all, we have to address the question of credit and finance. It's easy. Huh? Second, we have to address the question of market, irrigation, all the extension services, all the things that have fallen apart. But the most important thing that we have to address is what I call the technological element. All of us are against GMO. We are against biotechnology, right? That's true. Because biotechnology is not what we need. Nevertheless, the rural people in their production, they are technologically deficient. But they are still using holes in capacities. The solution is mechanical technology. How can we redefine the rural economy again to make it a full rural economy? That is a rural economy where farm and non-farm activities are as vibrant as ever. But let us redefine agricultural production to go beyond food production, to include industrial raw materials, right? If you cannot even export tomato and cotton to the US, then why are you going to export size something? To be able to have agricultural raw materials find the market, you have to think about re-industrializing. Because the only sector of the economy that needs agricultural raw materials for its own consumption is manufacturing. From textiles to this, to that, to that, to that. I'll tell you a story. Ghanaian farmers produce about 500 tons of maize every day. They will consume only about maybe a small percentage. So where was this corn going? All of them was going to Nigeria. So are the Nigerians so hungry? Of course they are not. The maize was going to the Nigerian brewery. Because at that time, Nigeria had a tariff limitation on barley. That is important. So it was forcing the use of local maize into beer. And the farmers were just producing a lot of corn and making a lot of money. So corn for domestic consumption and corn for industrial use, their income rose. So I'm talking about raising incomes through diversification. This agricultural interchange is very interesting. So basically, the whole post-modern, what we're trying to do was this. Or what they're trying to do was this. Nyerere, Nkrumah, Kaunda, and all this. Agriculture will provide efficient food, affordable prices to workers in the factories. It will also provide raw materials, and the manufacturing sector will provide the market. We buy consumable goods in terms of technological goods at cheap prices and provide machinery. That's the bargain. It can be done. It should be done again. We have to resurrect it.